You've almost certainly seen a periodic table of the elements, but have you ever wondered where those elements came from? To understand their origin, first we have to look at what defines an element. An atom is made up of positively charged protons and neutral neutrons in a nucleus, surrounded by negatively charged electrons. The number of protons in the nucleus defines an element, but a single element may have atoms with a varying number of neutrons. These are called isotopes, and though these are all still the same element, they vary in their stability. Some nuclei are stable and require large amounts of energy or bombardment by other particles to transform into different elements or isotopes. Other nuclei are inherently unstable and will spontaneously decay. We begin our story with the Big Bang. As the universe expanded and cooled, the sea of fundamental particles began to coalesce, forming the first protons. And a proton is the nucleus of the first element on the periodic table, hydrogen. In the first few minutes, a few more nuclear reactions occurred to create some helium and very tiny amounts of lithium. At this point, synthesis of larger elements was put on hold, until the inhomogeneity of the universe led to the formation of stars, which could become hot enough to allow for further reactions. Many stars start off small and are fueled by their ability to fuse hydrogen into helium, much like our own sun. Once their hydrogen fuel has been used up, stars which are massive enough go on to fuse together larger elements, while they themselves increase in size and temperature. But there is a limit to a star's ability to fuse smaller elements into larger ones. When small nuclei are fused together, the nuclear reaction releases energy, supplying the pressure needed to keep a large star from collapsing onto itself. But we reach a problem when a star forms iron 56. The nucleus of this isotope of iron is the most stable nucleus in nature, meaning that it can't be fused further to fuel a star. In other words, stellar nucleosynthesis halts at iron. At this point, the star has no energy to overcome gravity, causing it to implode and then rebound to explode in what we call a supernova. During a supernova, intense amounts of heat and gamma rays are produced. These gamma rays go on to break apart some iron nuclei into, among other things, copious amounts of neutrons. Intact iron then acts as a seed, capturing these neutrons and then decaying into new, heavier elements. Some of these new elements can even undergo nuclear fission to produce other ones. This process in a supernova is a primary one responsible for creating every element past iron, all the way up to plutonium. And since it is an explosion, all of these atoms are sent flying throughout the universe. But that still leaves a few more elements. Backtracking a bit, lithium, beryllium, and boron are not made in large quantities in stars. That's because these elements tend to be used up almost as soon as they are synthesized. Instead, they're made primarily by cosmic ray spallation, a process where high-energy particles collide with carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen, removing nucleons to yield these three smaller elements. And finally, every element larger than plutonium was made synthetically by scientists, though plutonium itself and a few smaller ones can also be man-made. In the end, all of these processes are responsible for creating every atom in the universe, including the ones that make up you and me and the entire Earth we live on. Now, understanding stellar life cycles and nuclear processes can be very complex, and this video just touched on the basics. If you're interested in learning more, feel free to ask questions below or check out some of the links included in the description. Check out Everyday Elements on Facebook, and above all, be sure to subscribe.